Good morning. Happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Good morning again, and happy Sabbath.
Happy Sabbath.
Thank you, worship team. That was awesome. It was great. It was a blessing. He really did pay all our debt. Amen?
Amen.
And we can stand here today, this morning, rejoicing that we have freedom. Wait a minute. What did we celebrate this week? What are we celebrating as a country? Freedom, independence. But yet, we can stand here and claim that we have spiritual freedom from sin, because not just several hundred years ago, but almost 2,000 years ago, a man named Jesus Christ claimed to be God, died on the cross, and we find evidence in Scripture and in history that he really was who he said he was. And what he came to this world to do was to die for your freedom, to set you free. Isn't that something good to rejoice in? Shouldn't we live every single day as though it was 4th of July, and live in the freedom that we have, the independence.
Amen.
Okay, after today's sermon, that amen is going to be stronger. Because let me tell you something right now. As Christians, I'm going to start off with, as Christians, we really just undermine the role of overcoming. What word did I just say? Okay, that's a dirty word, Christianity. As Seventh-day Adventists, even more, we have a message of overcoming, and yet we still shy away. And I always wonder why. Anyone struggle with sin? I'm raising both hands, by the way. Okay, those who did not raise your hands, please meet me afterwards, because I want your trick on how to overcome sin. Because right now, even the Apostle Paul, in one of the most magnificent letters in the Bible, he deals with this very issue of sin. There's something wrong in him, and he wants to solve the problem. And today I want to share with you the solution to your problem. I want to share with you the solution to the problem of your sin. Isn't that good news? Let's pray. Our gracious Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your love and your care. It is wonderful to stand here and celebrate freedom as a country, as a nation. But Father, we stand here even really proud and happy that we can stand free as men and women in Christ. So, Father, please, I pray that you lead us. You fill the sanctuary with your Holy Spirit and mighty angels. Sanctify our hearts and our minds, we ask in your name. Amen. Let's turn our Bibles to Romans chapter 7. Romans chapter 7, and I have some slides, but can you please forward that? The clicker's not working. Romans chapter 7. If you have your Bibles, that'll be great. If not, you can read it off on the screen. And we read the Bible and it says, "So I find this law at work. Although I want to do good," anyone feel like that? Okay, "although I want to do good, evil is right there with me." Man, anyone struggle like that? Verse 22, "For in my inner beings I delight in God's law, but I see another law at work in my members of my body, waging war." Anyone in spiritual warfare this morning? "But I see another law at work in my members, waging war against the law of my mind, making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within my members. What a wretched man," and you can insert there woman or child, "who can rescue me from this body of death. Anyone there? Anyone woke up this morning feeling as they're a wretched person, and there's clearly no way of solving the issue of your sin? Anyone woke up like that this morning? You don't have to raise your hand. I woke up this morning, I felt like that. Even though that I've preached this very sermon I'm preaching right now, I've preached it for 10, 11 times or so, I still deal with that issue. But I always can stand firm because I know that when I get on my knees, I can pray to a God who has a solution. And every single day, I can gain the victory and I can overcome that feeling of defeat. Anyone want to live like that? Victorious lifestyle? So, are you paying? Okay, we're going to have to work this way instead. So, the question that we have to ask is, why is everyone a sinner? Right? In Romans chapter 3, we read a verse that says, all have what?
Sin.
All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. In the Spanish translation, it says that you are destitute. You're not even allowed to be in the very realm of where God's glory exists. Not only do you fall short, but you've been completely shut out and pushed out because God's glory is so holy and you're such a sinner. You can't live there. But Paul makes two claims. The next slide, we're going to see that there's two reasons why we're sinners. In chapter 1, verses 18 through 32, we find this long list of sins. And we always say, oh, look, this is what the Gentiles do. We Christians don't do these things. But at the heart of chapter 1, verses 18 through 32, we find one key idea. Everyone has sinned and fallen short of the glory of God because they're what? They're idolaters. Do we worship idols? Do we worship idols? No? Wait a minute. You know, sometimes we say, I don't worship idols. I don't have anything in my house that I bow down to. But I'm going to ask you something. Do you have a concept of God, an idea of God that does not go according with this book? If you do, that's an idea. If you say, oh, it's okay for me to do this because my God is too big and will forgive me, that's already changing the idea and the perception of the God of the Bible. Yes, he does forgive, but he does not give permission to sin. So that right there, in turn, is idolatry. And we all have our little vanities in our hearts, in the darkest recesses of our hearts, and we have those little idols that we worship every single day. So Paul's case is everyone has sinned and fallen short of the glory of God because we're idolaters. Then in chapter 2, because he's speaking of Jews, he says, wait a minute, you guys don't start celebrating too much because you're not that far off either. You might say you're not idolaters, but you claim to be those who teach those who don't know the law. You go to church on Sabbath. You don't eat pork. Let me tell you, the identifying mark in our theology, if Israel lived in that area, was the lack of swine carcasses. That was an identifying mark of Israel as a nation. They were proud. But yet, Paul ends up saying God is blasphemed among the Gentiles because you failed to do so. You failed to live up to God's standards. So the second sin that Paul is trying to say in chapter 2 is that we are all proud. We have a pride issue. It's all about who? It's all about me. It's a one society, right? We had to keep up with the Joneses. Oh, so-and-so has a 75-inch or 78-inch screen TV. I need to have that too. You might not say that, but in your mind says, man, Christmas is coming around. My birthday is coming. My birthday is coming around on Friday. Thank you. That wasn't what I said. You know, if you do have a 78-inch screen TV that you would like to get, every single one of us has that sin problem. Anyone recognize that? Okay, right. I'm not just up here imagining things, right? You know, you're here with me, and in the boat with me is with Paul. We're struggling. We all have fallen short of God's glory. We all have sinned because we have idolatrous hearts and we're proud and boastful. So what's the solution? I heard Christ. That's a good answer. There's a more specific answer. Let's go to chapter 5. Chapter 5, verse 20. And let's all read this together, because this is a powerful verse. The law was brought with him. Are we all reading together? All reading together. The law was brought in so that the trespass might increase. But where sin increased, grace increased all the more. So where's the solution to your problem? It's the grace. Grace is the solution you're looking for. What Paul is trying to say is grace abounded even more. The word, I'm not going to get really technical, but the word literally means hyper, exceeded, hyper abounded the space that sin inhabited before. Imagine to have a container full of water. And that water represents sin. That whole entire container is full of sin. What God did, he went and poured grace in there, and he completely poured out every single ounce of sin and blew it up because he filled it with grace to the uttermost. When did he do that? When did grace explode out of the seams of this world? At the cross. When God became a baby, what did I just say? When God became a baby, subject to sin, to the hurts and the pains and sufferings and the result of sin, death itself, the author of life said, you know what? I want to be subject to death. He lived among us, and he hung on a tree by himself, all alone, for your sin. Isn't that grace?
Yes.
Grace is the solution. In Romans chapter 1, verse 17, Paul says that the just shall live by faith. There's another verse. That we are saved through what? Saved by what?
By grace.
By grace. Through what? Through faith. So how do you access the grace that hyper abounded this very space? Whoa. Let me give you a little backstory to the sermon. About 3 years ago, I think almost everyone knows I've only been in Adventist for 5 years. 3 years ago, so 2 years into my journey as a Seventh-day Adventist, I began to wonder what it means to be justified by faith. What does it mean to be saved by faith? And I began to question and just wanted to know more and more. So I went and dove into a long 4 or 5 month journey in Bible study. I'm in school, so I have time to do this. Any college student knows exactly what I'm talking about. We have all the time in the world. And as I was studying, I got the answer that I was looking for. I found the answer that I was not looking for. I knew it was the right answer. It was the correct answer. It was the biblical answer. It was you know, supported by the Bible, it was supported by the spirit of prophecy. It was very clear. I was not happy. Because it was too easy. The answer that I got was too easy. It had to be harder than that. How is it that you can tap in through faith, to grace through faith? That's too simple. I got to a classroom. Christian ethics, you know, how to live, you know, a Christian life. And I already knew in my heart that God wanted me to preach what I just studied at a church, because the church asked me to preach a sermon on righteousness by faith. And I knew God wanted me to preach that, and I said, no, I don't want to, because it's too easy. I'm not convinced yet. So the professor all of a sudden changes the syllabus, and he says, I'm going to talk about something totally different. The topic for today is righteousness by faith. And I sat back. And I'm blown away, right, because I'm in the back row, and I'm sitting there watching this ethics professor who I completely respect, and I all of a sudden go into my bag, pull the sermon that I have written out, and I'm looking at all the verses. And the very first verse that he goes to, the very first verse of my list, and verse by verse, he begins to pick it out, one by one. By the end of the class, he came to the same conclusion that I came to. And he made an appeal. He said, who wants to live by faith? And in my mind, I'm thinking it's too easy. But yet, already someone preached the sermon I was supposed to be preaching in 2 weeks. Brothers and sisters, I want to tell you something. It works. This works. And the phrase, you know, the just shall live by faith, that we find in the first, you can turn to the next slide. The next one, sorry. Yeah. The way that we can access that very last phrase, the righteous shall live by faith, it's actually found in the Old Testament. Next slide. Habakkuk 2, 4. Many of us actually think that the Old Testament is not full of grace, but here, the very statement that moved and propelled the right time of the Reformation comes out, that you find right here, behold, his soul is puffed up. It is not right within him. But the what? The righteous shall live by his faith. Wow. That's beautiful. But this verse actually refers to something more amazing. Next slide. Story, Genesis 15. Who's the actor here? Who's the main person in this story? Genesis 15. Anyone know? Who? Abram. I'm just going to tell you right now, I'm from the islands, so I do like when we talk, so you can say amen, and, you know, it's okay. I'm okay. I love when you talk back to me. Genesis 15, 1 through 5. We find this story, a beautiful story. After this, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Okay, this is the same Abram that was living in a faraway land, and God said, hey, I need you to go to this distant land that you have no idea, just go there, and I'm going to give you something amazing. And the man just got up and left. He was about 60, 70, left everything. Any retiree is willing to leave everything and move to somewhere they have no idea where to go. Great. After this, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. And he said, do not be afraid, Abram. I'm your what? Your shield. And here he says, your reward is very great. What God is trying to say is that I'm your very great, exceedingly reward. So what's the reward that Abram is supposed to receive? I'm sorry? God himself. The promise is God himself. It's God working in his life. He has a problem with sin. He has a problem that he's supposed to have inheritance. He's supposed to have all these children and nation, and a whole nation will be his descendants. He still doesn't have it. And God says, I'm your reward. Don't forget what I promised you so long ago. Yes, you're about 75, almost 80 years old. You still have no child. It's okay. Next verse. But Abram said, "Sovereign Lord, what can you give me?" Anyone been there? You're full of, no, like you're just steeped in your sin and say, "God, please." Overcoming? Yeah, right. "What can you give me since I remain childless? I have a sin problem. I can't stop doing whatever I do." Fill in your sin. Actually, don't let that sin if you don't like it. That's too rough. Your finances. You can put your finances in there. You can put your family problems. You can put in your studies, college degrees, work, relationships. Plug it in. "I remain childless, and the one who will inherit my estate is who? Eliezer of Damascus." And Abraham continues saying, "You have given me no children, so a servant in my household will be my heir." Next slide. Then the word of the Lord came to Abram. "This man will not be what?" Oh, I'm almost 90 years old. "But a son," God says, "but a son who is of your own flesh." Put this in your mind. Abram is almost 90 years old. We understand the pressure, right? And his wife is barren. It's impossible, correct? It's physically impossible to have a child at this age. "But a son who is of your own flesh and blood will be your heir." And God took Abram outside and said, "Look up to the skies and count what? Count the stars, if indeed you can count them." Then God said to Abram, "So will your offspring be." But again, Abram can't have kids. He's old. And his wife can't have kids. She's barren. So what does Abram do? Next slide. Abram, what? Abram believed the Lord, and he credited it to him as what? God declared Abram just because he believed. And you want to know what it literally means in the Hebrew? This is how it reads in the Hebrew. Abram, amen, the Lord. Did you hear what I said? Abram, amen, the Lord. Amen. Please, thank you. Someone got it. Abram literally said amen to God. And God said, "That's what I want. Amen. That is what I want from every single person from now on. Is for you to say, when you're faced with my promises of overcoming, of victory, is for you to say amen, God." Amen. Solution to your problem. How do you tap into the grace? A simple amen. Habakkuk 2:4, "The just shall live by faith." Literally says, "The just shall live by his amen." Overcoming. Overcoming is easy. It all starts with an amen. It just starts with you saying, "God, you're promising me victory of sin. You're promising me victory. Sin, finances, relationships, whatever it is, you're promising me this. And yet I don't know how in the world it's going to happen. It's physically impossible, spiritually impossible, whatever it is." God is simply just waiting for you to go and say, "Amen. Amen. Amen. Because there's nothing I can do. I clearly can't add to the situation, and I cannot solve the situation." God is simply just waiting for you to say, "God, I can't do it anymore. God, amen. You're promising me this. Amen." Paul understood this, by the way. This is not something I made up. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20. For no matter how many what? How many promises God has made for you personally, they are what?
Yes.
A what?
Yes.
A what?
Yes.
A yes in Christ. What does the next line say?
And so through him.
And so through him. Uh-huh. The what?
Amen.
Well, wait a minute. So even the amen that you're going to declare, when you feel inadequate and unable to fulfill whatever God has promised, because you say, as a human, I cannot do this. Even that amen that you say, God, you're promising me this, and I see it so far away, but let it be, God, even that is through grace. Your whole life revolves around that amen. You can start crying. Raleigh Seventh-day Adventist Church, it's time. It's time for us to not only just live the Christian life, but to recognize that to live the Christian life, it starts with you declaring an amen to God.
Amen.
Saying, Jesus, I can't do it. Please do it for me. That is the Christian lifestyle. It's not to be a holier-than-thou community or perfect community. It's just simply a community that says, I can't do it, but you can.
Amen.
Let it be yours. Is there anyone that wants to live that way? God sent his son to die on the cross so that you can live that way. So that you can tap into that grace. And so that you can say, amen. Let it be. You've promised so much to me. I don't know if that's going to happen. Let it be.
Chains, you have no more.
victorious living is very simple. It starts with the amen. It simply starts with you saying, God, let it be. It's not that hard. If you want to start that lifestyle today, I'm going to ask you to stand up. And when you stand up, I want you to actually, you can stand up now. But I want you to say something, because there's a power in verbalizing an idea. It simply goes like this. I can't do it, Jesus. You do it for me. Say it one more time. That's victorious lifestyle, right there. It starts right there. When you affirm that He can do the impossible for you. That feeling, that sensation that you might feel, remember that. Because every day is what you should be feeling like. That the impossible is very possible with Jesus.
Amen.
Let us pray. Our gracious Father, we thank you so much. We love you. We love you so much for this awesome gift that you've given us. That you sent your Son to die on the cross. To pay for our debt. To set us free. And to give us the power to live a victorious lifestyle. And Father, we thank you because it's not something that we gain by doing work. Or we don't gain by merits. We gain by tapping into the power by simply saying amen, God. Father, your word says that all of your promises are a yes in Christ. So I pray that for every single member of you. And I pray that their amen will be empowered by the blood of Jesus Christ. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn His face towards you and give you peace.